schools. Here's, you want to see the kind of weeks in which we've been going here. We can have that.
Oh, that's not the
weeks. That's not the weeks. Oh, these are the goals of our series: to learn about history and the forms of privilege, to listen to others, and to acknowledge white privilege. And here's the structure of the series. And Sue has agreed to open us with a prayer today.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Precious Lord, I just ask you to be with us as we gather this morning to seek understanding and to seek within our own selves how we look at racial issues, to realize that you, as the Creator of all, have made us all in your image, regardless of race or ethnicity. Just help us to open our hearts and minds to listen and to listen to each other. And hopefully through that, gain knowledge and understanding that we can all come together and praise you and live into what you created each of us in Christ's name.
Amen.
So last time I spoke to you all, a little bit about the ways in which racism has been embedded in American life and culture. And my general argument here is that it's really not enough for any of us to personally, to the extent that you can, make yourself colorblind. Being colorblind and saying, I don't see race, is really not a solution to the problem that we're facing here. Because people don't come in all colors. They come in the colors that are part of our nation, which are white, black, and brown, as we call them. And it's by those colors by which we have created barriers, established privilege, and it's only in understanding that privilege and understanding the extent of that privilege that we can really come to terms with what we have to do to solve the problems around race in our country. And so last time I had talked about the ways in which redlining and the Federal Housing Authority had created pockets of wealth, generational wealth, that advantage whites, not by the doing of any white person in this room right now or any anybody you know, but it's generational. We developed wealth because of policies, racist policies on the part of the federal government many decades in our past. I'm going to follow up. I'm going to show you another example of that today, the ways in which race is systemic in our country, and that we have to face that in order to be able to hear each other. And I'm going to add another layer to that today, which is to talk about the ways in which our institutions have given us promises in the past, have moved us forward. And my argument is that there's real potential in institutions such as the church, also in institutions such as schools. You can really see that potential if you look at the history of these institutions in our country. But you have to look at the fact that it's not a given. Just being a part of these institutions is not enough, because at the same time, sometimes these institutions have been the very institutions by which racial advantage has been embedded. There's a great deal of promise here, but we really have to think about what we're doing when we look at this policy. I have a few examples going back. I'm a 19th century historian, so I've been talking to you about the 20th century for you all, but it's a real stretch for me. I want to talk to you a little bit about the 19th century because one of the periods in which we've really seen some of the potential and also some of the problems of the Protestant church and the Christian church in the United States has been in the period in which our nation was fighting against slavery. This woman on the right here, Prudence Crandall, started a girls' school in her small town in Connecticut, and a free African-American girl asked to be a part of that school, and she let her be a part of it. And all the other white folks in town, Crandall was a clerk, and she decided that she should, in fact, allow this young girl to be a part of her school. The other African Americans the other whites pulled out, and she eventually created a school just for African American girls in the 1830s in Connecticut. successfully educated for a couple of years before the violence in the town and the ways in which the state actually passed what is clearly an unconstitutional black code that shut her down. But she showed that path, and she went on that path to kind of show those possibilities. It's not surprising as a Quaker that she would be on the forefront of this. Quakers were amongst the earliest in the Protestant church to realize that slavery was immoral and unethical. And they, by the time of the American Revolution, they were excommunicating their own members who continued to hold slaves. So it's a real potential there for the Quakers to look at this. The other part of this, and the part I think you have to realize, is that often when the Quakers were talking about this, they were talking about slavery in the way that the institution made them impure. That is, they thought slavery was wrong, and they did not want their members to all own slaves. But and many Quakers were really right-minded in general on the kind of the spiritual lives of everyone. But most Quakers who took this position really saw it in terms of their own conscience and their own spirituality rather than their brothers and sisters in Christ. Much of the antebellum church was like this. They thought that slavery was wrong, but it was often about their own spiritual consciousness and their own purity. We don't want this mark on our records, which is right, but they didn't take that to the next step. And what does this institution mean for the spiritual development of our brothers and sisters who aren't white? What about these people who have been enslaved or whose ancestors have been enslaved? So the Protestant church did push many people forward and in a position that was a very radical position to take in the antebellum years. Many people could be anti-slavery, which is to say the institution was wrong. It took a real radical to be an abolitionist to say, the institution is wrong and we need to abolish it right now, right? That was another step. And then a much, much rarer step was to be someone who would say, we need to abolish it and we need to change our thinking so that we accept those people who've been enslaved as our fellow humans, as our fellow brothers and sisters in Christ. And there's kind of three levels there. Those people who went that far to say that people of African descent were equal to them were very radical in the antebellum period, and it was a very dangerous position to publicly espouse. So it took a great deal of kind of spiritual strength, too, I think, to be in that position. Those people who did that really pushed the ball the furthest. And of course, as you probably know, eventually abolishing slavery became the goal of people who thought slavery was the wrong institution. So those radicals were the ones who won in the end, and they had to take that position for a couple of decades before they pushed everyone else to that position and put themselves out there. And just because I'm a women's historian, I have to tell you that part of the group that pushed this the furthest were the women who didn't have votes, right? Women didn't have votes during this time period, and they pushed the radical agenda in part because they weren't a part of the political system that was invested in keeping the institution of slavery there. Women went out at great risk themselves physically even to get petitions against slavery. And they sent it back. They sent those petitions, which would be full of women's signatures, they sent those to the United States House of Representatives. And because the House of Representatives was full of these political parties that didn't want to address this situation, because, like, if the Whigs talked about it because they were, what happened is they would lose all their Southern supporters, right? And so these national parties had national coalitions, half of which who didn't want to talk about slavery. So the U.S. Congress, as an institution, said, put a gag rule on themselves, that we're not going to talk about slavery. And you know who said, that's not right? Women radical Protestant abolitionists, right? And they continued to send petitions to Congress. We know this, that Congress gagged themselves, wouldn't even look at these petitions. And in the 1970s, a women's historian went into Congress and found these still sealed petitions, opened them up, and they were full of women's signatures, right? So they put themselves out there. But my you have to be willing to take a radical position, and you have to be willing to acknowledge that we have very invested systems against this radical position, and you have to be able to move forward. This is Charlotte Fortin, whose father, grandfather was a sailmaker. She's African American and was educated well. Though she was not particularly well physically, in the early years of the Civil War, she went down with other women to the Sea Islands, which is where the Union occupation had happened in the Civil War, and opened up schools, the first schools for African Americans in the slave South. And in the years of emancipation, there were many women from the North, African American and white, who went down to the South in the newly emancipated regions and opened schools, because education equals freedom, right? And education is enormously important. In many Southern states, the reason we have a public school system is because that brief period right after the Civil War and African Americans were enfranchised, before they were disenfranchised with Jim Crow at the end of the 19th century, in that period right after the Civil War, which ends in 1865, until about 1880 or so, there were many legislatures that were dominated by African Americans. When many of you all were in school, they were told you over and over again that Reconstruction was a failure. It was a failure on some grounds, but what they weren't telling you was that those black legislatures opened the first public institutions of many kinds, the first public schools in South Carolina, the first public universities that African Americans could attend under the land grant institutions in South Carolina, any of the first institutions for the insane, orphanages, all of those were set up by black Republicans during the period of Reconstruction. And when they got dispossessed of power at the end of Reconstruction, in the redemption, as it was probably taught in your school books, when they got dispossessed, they left those institutions in place. Now, of course, they seriously defunded them on levels of race, and so I have to make a quick privilege point here again for you. You're not really going to be able to see these too much, but you know that you're probably quite familiar with what happened in the early part of the 20th century as schools across these public institutions across the South were funded by formulas that left African Americans seriously unfunded. So for example, in South Carolina, the school board spent $1.70 per pupil if you were in a black school and $10.30 per pupil if you were in a white school, right? And across the board, what they paid the teachers, you know, what kind of institutions, buildings they lived in, just worked in, all those sorts of things were seriously unequal. This is what happened under the separate but equal legislation that we had between the 1890s until the Brown versus Board of Education case in 1955. So in 1955, the Supreme Court walks that narrow line and says, with all deliberate speed, we're going to do away with these unequal, there is no such thing as separate but equal, and we're going to do away with it, right? So beginning in 1955, though there is massive resistance, schools in southern states do begin to desegregate. And this is a process that takes a couple of decades. But by the 1970s, there's a fairly clear movement towards integrated schools, schools that would have at least 25% of the other minority, maybe as many as 30 or 40% of the other minority. And that happens through the 1970s. We're making progress. I graduated high school in 1980. I definitely went to a very integrated high school. The black high school in my town had been shut down in Lexington prior to, as part of desegregation. They just shut it down entirely. That's what happened in a lot of southern towns. Where the black high schools were shut down and they moved people around. There's a lot of inequities that happened here, but it did move forward. Those court-mandated integrations were mostly ended by, here in Dallas, it was ended in, I think, 2002, something like that, maybe the exact thing, something like that. When Farley started school, he started when Dallas was still under federal court-ordered mandated segregation. And I like to tell this story, although it's in some ways undercuts my point. But Farley went for his little interview at a magnet school in South Dallas, and you know, he was squirrely, he was Farley, right? And we end the interview, and he's off doing something. I lean over to the teacher, and I said, "Hi," I said, "he's not going to get in, is he?" And she said, "Oh, man," she said, "we really need whiteboards."
Yeah.
Oh, affirmative action quotas work for a white boy. What are we doing now? In any event, we can see that. So this happens across in the 21st century, 1990s, early 2000s. These court-ordered mandates begin to be let go of. Right, the court's no longer watching this. What has happened since then is that this is actually, these are probably in the worst order, the wrong order. What has happened since then is that the gains that occurred through that period of segregation have now been forestalled. So what's happening in these charts is, if you were born in the 50s, early 60s, as I was, right, the period in which these two lines are coming together, these are test scores, right? And you see how the races are coming together right here. And then if you're born later than that, those gains are no longer coming together, right? What's happened since people born in the early 1960s, so people who were finishing school in the 1980s, 1990s, we were moving in the right direction, which is there would not be a racial separation in scores. What's happened since then is that that racial separation has increased. As we've moved away from court-ordered desegregation, that's the exact corollary, as we've moved away from court-ordered desegregation, we've lost those gains. Now, what that actually is, I'll go back to these charts here. What that actually is, in large part, is poverty, right? Because race is correlated with poverty. And if you're in a school that is intensely impoverished, you're much less likely to be able to make the gains. So people that are deeply impoverished but are in schools that are not woefully impoverished, they make gains, right? But if you put impoverished people all together, they don't make gains. And that's what's happened. We have schools, something like 6% of schools now are what I would call apartheid schools, that is 1% non-majority, right? And in those schools, you see the most significant measures of unequal gains in test scores. ProPublica has done a story on this, and what happened sort of in my town, they closed the black schools and then they integrated the white schools, and since the 1990s, they've opened back up these high schools, and they are drawing lines or allowing things to happen so that the schools are separated. So there's two schools now in Tuscaloosa, Alabama, and Central, which used to be an integrated school, is now once again a black school, and it has, you know, until recently it didn't have physics, it doesn't have a college newspaper, it doesn't have AP classes, and the white school in that district on the other side of town has all of those things and more. And you can't be surprised when there are the sort of differences in who, this is college graduation, right? And you can't be surprised that you get these growing differences between the races if you're going to prepare them differently for that outcome. Okay, part of this might be, of course, because another thing that's happened and that's connected to the poverty is the incarceration rates. I don't want to have a lot of time, we probably ought to spend some time talking about massive incarceration in our country. But massive incarceration, if you look at this, what year you were born in and the likelihood that you spent some time in a prison. In the 1950s, this was the racial difference between your likelihood of spending time in prison. The 1960s, it's 19% versus 4%. And look at this, if you were born in 1970 and you're a black male, there is a 26% chance that you spent some time in a prison, right? So you take black men out of black families and you destabilize the communities, and you destabilize families, and you get a lot of poverty, and you get those other things that I was talking about. I have a lot more time to talk about massive incarceration, but I think it's part of what we ought to do. Churches have been here. Churches started by African Americans themselves, along with churches that allowed for a certain amount of integration. The Episcopal Church in America did, in fact, integrate early on in Philadelphia. They allowed African American members, as did the Methodist Church in Philadelphia. This is Absalom Jones. Do we learn about him in seminary? Absalom Jones, right? Who was an African American who started the African Episcopal Church. His friend Richard Allen, he started the Free African Society in Philadelphia. In the 1790s, they started these institutions. There's a very famous story, though, involving Richard Allen that also shows the kind of lack of the absence here. So Richard Allen was a Methodist. He had been hanging with Absalom Jones, but Absalom Jones and others were didn't have the fervor, the Methodist fervor, that called to Richard Allen. And so Richard Allen went to a white Methodist church called St. George's Methodist Church. They called him and they asked him to preach to their African-American members. Richard Allen was a wonderful Methodist preacher, and he grew the church. St. George's grew, and it grew so big that they needed a new institution, and they helped them raise money, the African-American members, to raise money for this new institution. And this new church, and they built this new church, and the first Sunday they're in worshiping in this new church, Richard Allen is praying, and they come up and they say to him, but now that we have a balcony, the black members are supposed to sit up in the balcony. And Richard Allen said, hold it, let me finish this prayer before you move me. And they went and got an usher, and they physically moved him because they wanted to put him up into the balcony where the black people were supposed to be in St. George Methodist, the new St. George Methodist Church. And Richard Allen walked out of that church, and he took every black member with him when he walked out. He never went back to St. George's Methodist. And in fact, what he started with was Bethel, which was the first African AME church, African Methodist Episcopal Church, in Philadelphia. It's the mother church in general. The same sort of thing happened across this bottom left here. Picture is a picture in Savannah, Georgia, in the antebellum period, where free blacks and enslaved blacks formed the African Baptist Church in Savannah. So these churches, they did get funding and they did get support from some of the larger Protestant churches of their denomination. So there's real potential there. But they also, we can also kind of look at the limits of this. So Frederick Douglass said in his narrative that the worst slaveholders were the religious slaveholders, because the religious slaveholders were most certain of their righteousness in holding slaves. And in fact, if you count all the apologies for slavery that came out of the South before the Civil War, over half of them were written by clergy, right? So the Southern Church was not a place that really, in fact, it underscored the lines of racial difference in slavery. At the same time that it was empowering people like Prudence Crandall and all those abolitionists, it was empowering Southerners. And so eventually, most Protestant churches in the antebellum period split into their northern and their southern branch. The only mainstream Protestant church that did not split in the antebellum period was the Episcopal denomination. Even during the Civil War, they set up chairs for the Southerners to come to the National Convention. You know, arguing that we needed to all be under one tent to talk about these things. My larger point here is that these churches really did have potential. And then I'll give you one other example of this during the Civil Rights Movement, as Bruce can talk to us about. Martin Luther King was really pressed during the Civil Rights Movement about what he was doing. He, when he was sitting in jail, he wrote the very famous letter from the Birmingham jail, in which he really called upon the principles of Christianity. He said, I'm here because justice calls me to be here. And the letter from the Birmingham jail was, in speaking on Christian terms, really appealed to clergy across Protestant and I think other Christian lines to come to his side. And I've got here the picture from the March in Selma, where many, many different Protestants came. And that was really a kind of critical moment in the Civil Rights Movement, was when white churches in the North saw this as their call. talk about this for us. So my larger point here is that again, there's real potential. We can do really great things. We have to recognize that it will be a radical act, and that there are systemic barriers to what we want to achieve. We've got to think about those systemic barriers and how to proceed.
And it's funny because I am not a 20th century historian either, but one of the things I learned was Bishop Denby was the first African-American bishop ordained in the Episcopal Church, so it was a great step forward, but they also didn't give him any salary. So,
this has been a I don't know if it works or not, I was using the one on there.
I guess it's not.
Okay.
Talking with inside the Episcopal Church and kind of at three levels, the local level, the diocesan level, and the national level. And I have a couple of examples here. At the local level, I want to talk a little bit about All Saints in Austin. At the diocesan level, I honestly couldn't find much of what we were doing. I looked at the bishop's blog to see what he was talking about, and it's not race, it's not Charlottesville, it's not those things. So I know that there are some things that are happening, and Deacon Sue shared some information with me, so we can talk about that. But I think we also have to think about when we are going to do things. You can't have racial healing until you have recognized white privilege. You can't have reconciliation until you've said, I'm sorry, and you've recognized that you've done. And to make sure that those of us who are white have done that, those of us who are non-white have a seat at the table, are seen and are heard. And then at the national level, because I haven't really heard a whole lot about that, that was in Salt Lake in 2015, so I wanted to speak a little bit about that. So first, All Saints Episcopal Church. This is just a picture of what it looks like with the altar here, and you can see there's three stained glass panels behind it. And that little spot in orange that I highlighted, we're going to focus in on that part. And this is a picture of Bishop Tuttle, who was a great missionary bishop, and Robert E. Lee, as examples of strong Episcopalians. So I read about this story in the Texas Standard, and now I have to make a confession. I am so used to my own place of privilege that when I saw that article, I looked it up and I went to their website and I called the rector, who wasn't there. I thought, well, I'll call the assistant rector, and she wasn't there. And in the article, because it had given me those names, in the article it mentioned there was one African-American staff person there who was not named. And I look at their website, everyone's got colored photos, and I recognize that he was in sexton. I wasn't quite sure what that is, but I found out it's a facilities manager. So I called him, and I had the opportunity to speak with Marvin Jones, who was gracious and kind and talked to me about their process. And you know, I'll give you the ending right away. They've decided to remove the window. But it was, how did a local church have that conversation? Where did that come from that was interesting to me? So what happened was, there were only three African-American members of that church, and one of them left. And she wrote a letter to the assistant rector leaving, saying, I've got to leave. This window is just so offensive. I cannot bring another friend to our church and have them see that right behind the altar. So this was actually a problem of evangelism. Racism is an obstacle to our spreading the good news of Jesus Christ. This woman brought this up and she left. And the church, to their credit, didn't just say, oh, well, she's gone, we can stop thinking about it. They started a process where they had dinners in people's homes, so they didn't have a meeting and have it descend into like some big free-for-all. They had meetings in people's homes where first they had a dinner, shared, broke bread. And after the dinner, there was a moderator, and every person in the room could speak for, there was a certain amount of time of, what does this window mean to you? What do you think? Everyone got a chance. And then they had another chance, and it went around again, and they could either speak more about their thoughts on that window, or they could raise up some other questions and comments. So everyone had a chance to be heard. And Mr. Jones told me that very frequently, he went to about 5 of the 8 dinners. Very frequently, he was the only African American there. But he felt like people heard him. And in that whole conversation, what he tried to express to me was, it's not the glass, it's not the window. He said, it's the heart, not the glass. And that he had felt so accepted at that church. He said, these are my friends. I'm invited to their homes, I'm part of their families. So I think there's hope, and I think that church in Austin gives us an example of how we can have healthy conversations about white privilege, about our slave legacy, and to move forward. The General Convention, I think, is another place where we can have some hope, some thought about it. I may be explaining this incorrectly, so somebody jump in. But to my understanding, the National Convention is really a conversation that starts with the diocese sending representatives to the National Convention. They're part of the House of Deputies. Bishops are part of this whole thing in the House of Bishops. And resolutions get discussed, and you can either have concurred, take no action, rejected, referred, not completed, or adopted by only one house where the other house doesn't need to vote. In general, both houses have to agree. And I want to highlight 4 that were concurred. The only one that really touched on racism or white privilege at all that didn't get concurred was one about disability, and I think it just didn't really fit into disability. So here are the 4. 1 seems pretty clear. We should discontinue using the Confederate battle flag. This one is to pray and act for racial recognition as part of our witness to the gospel. So really that insight that the church in Austin had, white privilege, racism, that perspective is an obstacle to sharing the good news. And for these different houses to work on the church's work of racial justice and reconciliation, and that term is important, racial justice, to recognize that what people have suffered under racism is an injustice. To create youth curriculum, anti-racism curriculum, this resolution calls on the Officer for Youth Ministries and Missioner for Racial Reconciliation to commission a gospel-centered, internet-integrated, action-oriented anti-racism youth ministry curriculum for congregations, and to make both printed versions and an online version of this curriculum. And this is one maybe that we can focus on and discuss a little more, is this idea of liturgy. So using education, community dialogue, and internal audit to respond to all forms of racial injustice. I know it's kind of long, but I'm going to read it. Urges the church at every level to increase dialogues about systemic racial injustice, improve education on racial injustice, and create and share resources on curriculum and programs dedicated to ministries of reconciliation. I had no idea this was there, and we just decided to do it. I think the Holy Spirit had led
us. We're now
us.
In compliance.
Because we're now in compliance, but I want to thank Deacon Sue for pointing me to the summary of actions. I had no idea it existed, but here we are. A few specific suggestions are included. Also ask the Standing Commission on Liturgy and Music produce and post online a set of prayers for racial reconciliation and justice, and that the Executive Council conduct an internal audit to
to assess whether racial injustices exist within the church. So let's talk a little bit about liturgy, which is not really in my comfort zone. I'm not a liturgist, and I don't sing very well. But I know how important liturgy is to our identification. When I was part of another faith tradition prior to this, I remember being in Florida on vacation, and I went to a weekday mass. It's Florida. There was one elderly male priest, because this tradition only has male priests. And he looked at the congregation, which was 8 older ladies, myself. And he does the offertory, receives the gifts, and puts them down, and he turns to them, and he says to us, and he says, "Pray, my brothers." And all I remember thinking is, you ain't got no brothers here. It was that inability to see who was there. And I felt completely erased and not seen. How are you looking at these 9 women and saying, "Pray, my brothers," right? So I don't have that experience of not having been seen or heard racially or ethnically. But this is the kind of a thing that I think that people may want to talk about. And so it's wonderful that we have a resolution for the revision of the Book of Common Prayer. Would not want to be on that committee. There's another one that talks about linguistic diversity and says, let's translate portions of the Book of Common Prayer in different languages, French, Creole, Spanish. And it starts making me think, sometimes we think of African Americans and whites, and that's the only colors going on here. But actually, there are Afro-Caribbean people. There are people who are both Latino, Latina, and of African descent as well. And lots of things going on, people who are African here. So why do we assume that translating is a good idea? Translating privileges what already exists, which comes out of a white culture, a predominantly English culture, right? And English, England English, not our version. My relatives tell me, "Oh, it's so you can speak American too." Yes, I can. But why not create new texts in that language, and then, if necessary, translate them into English, right? These are all the little ways we have to retool our brains to think away from white privilege. The revision of the hymnal, another committee I do not want to be. But one of the things this author, Brian Combs, was making me think about was that we have the hymnal, 1982, and we have these supplements. He says, you know what? Supplements are at the margins. They're not at the center. What are we putting in at the center? I also learned about a book of prayer I did not know about. I know the BCP, it's in red. There's also a book called The Book of Occasional Services. Yeah. Had never heard that. And again, things that are not in the main book are marginalized. There's a mindset here that we have one prayer book and we have one hymnal. Other national churches, I found out, do not do it this way. They have a series of resources. Maybe we need to think about this. Another point that he made that was so excellent was that better hymns does not equal, I figure those of you who are still young and in math knew this one, does not equal better liturgical music. You know, what's our liturgical music? The Gloria, the Holy, 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 the Sanctus, right? That's not the same thing. So just tacking on a nice spiritual at the end isn't necessarily increasing your whole worship experience. And then A060 seeks funding for an online resource for world music. So I feel like in the National Convention, there were all these great starts, all these places we could go. And now, there's some work to be done. I feel like
churches like All Saints are showing us ways we can go. We don't have any particular window that we need to work on, but we may think of other things that we do need to work on. I just want to give some time now to folks here to comment. Are there things that you would like to see, things that you have heard about at either the diocesan level or the national level or the local level that you think would be important in these areas?
Or any other questions or comments?
Do you know if they've actually done a curriculum for the youth for, I mean, it's been 2 years. I know that's asking a lot. I could do it. But
Sarah's back there. Do you know?
I couldn't hear what the question was.
Has there been a curriculum worked?
I was thinking as I read that, I don't know that that's happened. I have not heard that.
Perhaps that's something we could work on.
It's not something that is like widely disseminated.
So, I mean, they just to be critical, which I am, they do all this stuff, and we don't even hear about it. I mean, I didn't know that they were supposed to be doing some of this stuff.
I didn't hear about any of this until Deacon Sue told me.
I mean, there's not a...
Not that it's her fault.
There's not a way for it. I mean, there needs to be a communication. And then there needs to be follow-through and accountability. And is there accountability at the national level?
So tell us what... She got an email just this week. Tell us about the email you got this week.
What made me talk to Annalise about this was that was it last year we went to San Antonio? Our archdeacon could not go to the diaconal convention that they were holding in San Antonio, so she called and asked if I could go. And I took Lanny with me just so, you know, in the evenings we could go out. But as we had these meetings with other deacons from around the country, one of them was on racial issues in the church and or lack of inclusion. And I started hearing other deacons talking about what their diocese was doing after this convention as far as trying to bring racial conversation into their church. And what some things they were doing was they had paired with a church in their community that was mostly African American. And they got together and they worshiped together, but they also had small groups and they had meals together in members' homes on both sides just to talk about their racial conceptions and how can we come together and how can we try to understand and realize what our inner feelings are and what yours are and how we can come together. And they had some programs going that were unbelievable. And I was sitting there thinking, because they told me that this had been mandated at convention, that racial issues be talked about on a diocesan level in the churches, and I had heard nothing about it. And I worked for the diocese at the time at Cathedral Gardens. And so when I came back, I met with the archdeacon and also with Diane Luck, who used to be archdeacon, and said, I had nothing to add to this. I was like shocked to hear about this. I don't understand why I haven't heard anything about it. And they said they didn't have any idea either, that they knew it had been brought up in the beginning, but nothing had happened. And I still have been. Well, then this week, I'm sure you got the email about the clergy thing.
Which day?
I know there was one about washing children's feet and giving them shoes.
Reconcile Dallas?
That's what I was
wondering.
Yeah, I think that's what it is.
So on a diocesan level, I might just add while we're looking for this, because it was what came to mind for me too. The bishop has worked to develop some ecumenical partnerships, particularly with some historically black churches in South Dallas, and trying to show collegiality, but also offering some Bible studies with those pastors and clergy of our diocese, and now is taking the next step towards some outreach endeavors where we can partner together and go and serve in kind of meaningful capacities in our own communities to try to move forward in a process of healing. So I do feel like we're making some progress as a diocese in that light. I don't know if it's a perfect response to the resolution or not, but I believe this kind of thing is. So some of it happens whether or not there is an awareness of the resolution, because there is some good energy. Good, the Holy Spirit may guide us even where resolutions don't. And I do think there is kind of a perpetual frustration, and that the inherent problem of a resolution is, you know, you can post something to a website, but you still have to go to it to see it and read it, right?
It is called Reconcile Dallas Unity Service. It says Sunday, October 16th, but the 16th is a Monday.
So
that's the
embedded problems in having people show up. Is it Sunday or is it the 16th?
It says Episcopal Diocese of Dallas parishes will join congregations from across Dallas to pray for reconciliation and unity in our city. And then there are volunteers needed to join churches across the Metroplex to wash children's feet and provide new shoes for 2,000 children in South Dallas. So,
yeah, I mean, I think these are good things, but I think the reason that we do this kind of training and education is, as Stephanie was saying, there are systemic reasons. Why do black people need more shoes than white people? Because in South Dallas, they've been exempted from certain economic development because of I-75 driving a certain way, right? So it is important to reconcile, it is important to serve, but there's a difference between charity and justice, and I feel like we need to always add to our own knowledge of the circumstances to call for justice and to go beyond just charity, right? Sarah, were you gonna say something?
I was just gonna, on a little different note, but two things I wanted to say is on the diocesan level as well, and I've already just kind of mentioned this to Annalise, but I met with the associate this week at Transfiguration who want to have Annalise and Stephanie come and speak to their congregation as well. I haven't mentioned that yet, Stephanie. I haven't gotten a chance to tell you that yet. But, so I think that there are parishes that really want to do that and really want to see that happen and want to have their entire congregations, not just the clergy or not just the representatives at diocesan conventions, to talk about those things and hear about those. But there's parishes that really want to have that same education and knowledge for all of the congregations. So I'm really inspired by that. My other point I was going to make as we talk about local and diocesan and national is locally, right here at this church, we have an African congregation that meets here. Oftentimes people, I hear all kinds of people say like, oh, we have two services, an 8 and 10. That is not true. We actually have a 12 o'clock service that is a part of our congregation, and they are a part of our congregation, and we need to remember that so we're not marginalizing them as well.
That's a good point. Any last comments, or we should finish now? I think it would be really appropriate if you would close us with some prayer. Would you mind?
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Lord, we give you thanks for this community of faith and the presentation we've received this morning. Lord, we know that we've only begun to recognize that which we need to enter into in terms of justice and reconciliation. We ask that you open our hearts and our minds to your truth, that you might guide us in these steps. That you might keep us mindful of our learning today, that we might continue to grow in our understanding. We might continue to strive to be one. And we might continue to receive the unity that only your Spirit can provide. We ask all of this in Jesus' holy and life-giving name. Amen.
Thank you.